The challenges of covering the Rio Olympics, next on Carpe Diem. Hello, I'm Marc Rosenweig, Associate Professor in the School of Communication and Media at Montclair State University. Welcome to part two of our discussion on covering the Rio Olympics. During a panel discussion at the Yogi, Berra Museum and Learning Center on the MSU campus, I talked with two reporters who covered the Rio Olympics. Bruce Beck is the lead sportscaster for NBC4 in New York. He's covered the Olympics for more than a decade, and he's a nine-time Emmy Award winner. Karen Crouse is a New York Times correspondent and a leading writer on sports and society. She was honored by the Associated Press as one of the top 10 beat reporters in the country. I asked the panelists about the impact of social media on their coverage.
Twitter is informational driven. I have Instagram, which is more photo related, and Facebook, which is also, I think, driven more by photos and a lot has to do with family. But Twitter has become such a competition among all of us. And everyone is tweeting that's, let's say, on the Yankee beat. And we get news from Girardi, manager Joe Girardi, that somebody's out of the lineup. I see it instantly on my feed because I'm right there. Nine guys are saying the same thing, that somebody is out tonight. So they want to deliver to their followers quickly. And that competition is not just about that. Now it's breaking stories. Now it's getting inside stuff. Now you want to be retweeted so that it can help your number of followers, your overall reach. Social media has changed the landscape and the way we cover things, because you could cover it from your desk and follow what people are saying. When I'm running to a press conference in Florida that I'm late to, I'm following it on my phone as I'm driving, which is really not safe. But, you know, I'm seeing what the guy's saying, and when I get there, I'm equipped to ask a proper question because I know what happened. But the social media game is dangerous because pushing that button is not always smart. Why not hold, use restraint, and get less followers, or guess less of a range or an overall bandwidth? The whole concept here is to be first, and that's not always great. I'd rather last longer in the business and tweet less and have less followers than to be first and be wrong. But at the same time, Karen, we're not accountable, because so many people will take a shot, say something, and then their prediction's wrong or their facts are wrong. No one calls them out. No one holds them accountable.
Well, I would rather be right than first. So I guess I'm an anomaly. If you look at my Twitter feed and see how few Twitter followers I have, you'll see that I'm not living and dying with social media. And I feel like I have to look at myself in the mirror every day, and I try to treat the people I cover the way I would want to be treated. I know this sounds really just probably passe, you know, like very quaint and just out of touch with this fast-paced society, but I just feel a huge responsibility to try to tell people's stories correctly, because I've once or twice in my life been on the receiving end where I've been the subject of news, and I know how it feels when people take things you say out of context or get facts wrong, and it is the most helpless, vulnerable, miserable feeling. So I will go to great lengths at the expense of getting yelled at by my editors to maintain my integrity and maintain the ability to look at my subjects in the face the next day.
When you were talking about your personal experience, I'm assuming some of it has to do with Augusta National golf course.
Yes.
Give us a snapshot of what that was
okay,
about some
so
years ago.
Okay, so this could probably be a whole nother panel.
Yes.
It could yes. Like, how long do you have? But in short, my first year covering the golf beat for the New York Times, I got sent to the Masters, and I had covered the Masters before, but always set very small papers, and by small I mean, you know, under 200,000 circulation. So I'm arrive at the Masters, and it happens to be the year that IBM, one of the four main sponsors of the tournament, has just elevated to CEO its first female, Virginia Romedy, and yet the Augusta National remains an all-male club, and they traditionally gave an honorary membership to every CEO at IBM. The men who had preceded Virginia had been accorded that honor. She was not. So I've watched, my first Masters that I covered was 1998. So I had watched this issue play out over the years. And my rejoinder to people who said it's a private club, they can do whatever they want, they can have whoever they want as members is, well, it's a private club that 1 week a year holds the most public tournament in the sport. So by virtue of holding this tournament that is a showcase for golf for not only the country but the world, you're giving up some of that ability to claim the higher ground of privacy, or the lower ground in this case of wanting your own rules. So I felt like this had now become an untenable position for the club, that it would have been so easy for them to just name her an honorary member and therefore break their all-male club policy, and they would have done it in a very organic way. Not at the point of bayonet, as their chairman had said. So when they didn't, I thought, okay, this has to be addressed. And so I wrote, this was a little tricky because we didn't have a columnist here. We have in the audience Harvey Ariton, who was a columnist at the time, and I wish he would have been at this. Would have saved me some problems, but. So they had me as the beat writer write an analysis, and so I wrote, like, kind of tried to point out the absurdities of the situation. And the day the column ran, the analysis ran, was the first day of the tournament, and a former colleague who then worked at Sports Illustrated said, "Oh, Karen, I really liked your piece today, you know, it was really strong." And I said, "Well, thank you. You know, the covering this event as a woman is becoming harder and harder, because wearing a credential almost feels like I'm giving tacit approval to the status quo, which I now find untenable." Well, unbeknownst to me, his boss, the man in charge of the website, had overheard me, and so he came up to me and said, "You know, we're putting together a Voices blog, and I heard what you said, and we would love to have your voice in this blog. I don't know if you know, but President Obama came out today and he decried this policy, urging the club to open its membership to women. So we would love to add your voice." And so I said, "Well, I'm going to have to go through my channels and make sure it's okay." So I called the golf editor and explained what they wanted me to do, and we had actually had this exact conversation the previous day, and so she knew that this is how I felt. She said, "Well, as long as you make sure they know that you do not get to choose your assignments." And I said, "Oh, you know, I get that." So I did speak to this reporter for this blog. So a few hours later, as it happened right on deadline, the blog is posted, and the headline is NYT reporter to boycott Masters.
Oh my.
So I saw firsthand how a quote can be completely taken out of context.
Manipulated.
Because
wow.
My quote was, if I had my druthers, and I don't, I would prefer not, I hedged it any which way you could. I would prefer not to cover this event again until they have female members. And there were no other voices, it was just me. So now I'm just crestfallen, and I feel, what can I do as a journalist? Say, oh, I was misquoted. I mean, we get upset at subjects when they say that. So I felt like, well, lesson learned, I'm just gonna have to swallow this dose of medicine. And then the then female sports editor at Associated Press decided this was a big story, must have been a very slow news day, and she assigned one of her writers to do this story on the New York Times sports writer who is maybe boycotting this event in the future because of this club policy. And they interviewed my sports editor, who said that Crouse had her comments were completely inappropriate, and she has been spoken to. So that opened up a whole new can of worms, and I started getting emails from readers saying, wow, you think that Augusta is sexist. You've got some problems in your own sports section. And so it became this huge mess, and the whole week I felt like I had this black cloud hovering over me. And because the people of Augusta, the members of Augusta, are the most powerful men at this point in the world, people are afraid to cross them. And so the fact that I had spoken out against this club made me radioactive. No one wanted to be seen talking to the person who had caused this kerfuffle. So for 4 days, literally no one would talk to me. The only people who would talk to me were the players, and God bless them for being completely oblivious to what was going on outside their sphere. But I did have a really great ending to the week. So Sunday was Easter Sunday, and so my mother I called my mother to just wish her a happy Easter. And in the course of our conversation, she said, you know, so Karen, I've been reading that there's some controversy about women belonging to this club. Have you done anything on that? And I thought, oh my gosh, here I feel like I've just been under siege all week. And you don't have to go very far outside your circle. You can still be in your inner circle.
Tell mom you are the story.
And realize how unimportant this is in the bigger scheme of things.
Well, she obviously wasn't checking her Twitter feed
regularly.
Yeah, it
shows you that my own family does not read my stuff. Yeah, but there you go.
Yeah. Bruce, when you think about the Olympics and we look to the future, there was a story this morning written in the Times about more drug testing and people failing the drug tests that were revisited from Beijing and London and so on. Is this something that deserves more scrutiny? Should reporters be following this? What do you think about that?
We always think that the athletes are ahead of the curve, whether it's Olympics or major sports in the U.S., the four major sports. You always wonder if an athlete is ahead of the curve, and we saw it in cycling as well. So I think there'll be continued to be additional scrutiny. I mean, but in the last decade, we've seen a big change in Major League Baseball, in football. The testing has gotten much more serious. The game has changed. We saw that Major League Baseball rid steroids, so to speak, from their sport. They've done a very good job. And look, it's always going to be something. You know, now we're dealing in the NFL with head trauma and concussions. We're dealing in all sports with the issue of domestic violence. There's always going to be something, because sports in many ways is an extension of society, you know, a microcosm of society.
Mirror, yeah.
It really is. And you know, you look at problems that happen and involve in the NFL, they're not different from what's going on in society. But because he's an athlete that we all look up to, and because we cover him, and because he's throwing for a touchdown pass on a Sunday, makes it maybe a bigger point and makes it more tangible for somebody to see and to talk about. But these are issues in society. So to answer your question, yeah, I think there'll continue to be issues in terms of testing and looking at doping. But we've seen that for years, going back to the East German bloc and going back to the Eastern European nations that, you know, had problems for years, many years ago, with the Olympic Games and with other different cheating. I mean, it's the way the world is. Who can win? How can you win? Does it mean you have to cheat? And now, are you getting caught cheating? These are issues we're going to see for many years, and we'll be covering them.
Yeah.
You had asked earlier, you were kind enough to ask about my book.
Yes.
And I feel I'm writing this book. It's my first book. I'm super excited about it because I feel like in many ways the Olympics are broke. You have the people who are supposedly trying to keep the sport clean are also invested in the success of the Olympics. So are people who are affiliated with the IOC really going to be dogged about finding a very popular gold medalist as a drug cheat? It would hurt the brand. So there's this inherent conflict of interest. Money has become so big, and money corrupts. And so you have host cities that are throwing money they don't have at IOC officials who are pocketing it. Everyone is making money, including very few of the athletes. I mean, there is the big lie is that you win a gold medal, you're on easy street for the rest of your life. Huge lie. But people look at the Lindsey Vonns and the Michael Phelpses and the Missy Franklins and they think, oh, wow, these athletes are all getting rich. No, like 0.5% of them are making enough money. The rest are, many of them, probably the greater percentage that I've covered, are becoming poorer in pursuit of their sport. So in many ways, the system is broke. And I found this very tiny town in Vermont that has put 11 of its own on Olympic teams, and it's done it in the most organic way. The kids are not steered to sports. They're not specializing early. They're finding their passions. They're developing it organically. They're not in the sport. They're in these fringe sports for the most part. So they're not in the sports to get rich. They're in it because they love their sport. So they do the sport they make the Olympic team in many of these instances. And then they use it as a springboard to their next act. And all of them have gone on to very productive, fulfilled second acts, which, as Bruce can tell you, is not a given for some of these people who we think of as the most successful, the gold medalists. Sometimes they have a very difficult time making that transition to the real world. So I feel like in the telling of this story of this town, there's a recipe for how to restore sanity to the Olympic movement.
That's interesting because these stories that she's pointing out, I mean, I've got fencers that I cover that some of them get a stipend if they've achieved, if they get a medal. So they might get $2,500 a month, and that goes towards training for a year. I'm on a plane coming back from the Olympics, and some of the most high-profile athletes you can imagine are going to the back of the plane. Michael Phelps is going to the front. That's one of the only ones that is. These athletes, in many cases, really are working all year, to maybe 4 years, to get to the point to compete.
Maybe 12 years.
Maybe 12. Yeah, maybe, yeah. You know, whatever it takes. It is not an easy path, and very few succeed.
And very few get rich.
Absolutely. So there's only a few cases. And when you hear these beautiful stories, I love them. So it's not a utopia. The Olympics is not a utopia. I still believe in what the overall concept is. I'm not always enamored by the way, you know, you see certain athletes go through certain aspects of their lives and this whole process that she's talking about, but I see it in all sports. I've covered sports for over 35 years in the New York marketplace, and I spend more time covering jurisprudence than I do the achieving, you know, success that I see from guys, it's or women, it doesn't matter. But this is what we are today. This is what our society is. We crave controversy. We want to know how someone really is doing it. Is it being done legally? Is it being done illegally? Similar to what we saw during this whole political race, which was the most fascinating time in the history of American politics. But it was ugly, it was dirty, it was malicious, it was personal. It's a microcosm of what's going on out there.
So having said all of this, when will the Olympics be in the U.S. again so we can experience this firsthand? What are the prospects?
The next three.
We've got three 2024 for sure.
2024 would be the first time, we hope so.
In L.A. because I think
I'll be in Asia, I think, the next three.
I have this gut feeling that the excesses of Sochi and Rio have really paved the way for L.A. in 2024 because L.A. only needs to build one venue. The last Olympics that made money was the 1984 Games in LA, and I think the Olympic movement once again is going to look to Los Angeles to right the wrongs. And Paris is the other favorite, but I think it's the specter of terrorism in Paris is just impossible to ignore. So for those reasons, I think LA is, in my mind, almost a lock.
We're going to South Korea next.
And in Japan.
We're going to Tokyo, which should be fascinating. Mm-hmm. And we're going back to Beijing for the Winter Games after we've been there for the Summer Games, which really doesn't make a lot of sense.
I was
going
to say, where's the ski slope there?
Well,
must be out of town.
Let me give you an example. Sochi is a summer resort town. And we were there for the Winter Games. And it was warmer in Sochi than it was back here in February.
It was actually colder in West Palm Beach a few days than it was in Sochi during the Winter Olympics.
I'd still rather be in West Palm Beach.
I'd much rather be in L.A. than to be in some of these other destinations, you know.
All right, we'll look forward to that. One of our students asked the panelists how concerned they are about the spread of fake news on the internet and elsewhere.
So disheartening. For those of us who care so much about reporting and getting facts right, I mean, I worry if I don't have a quote exactly verbatim, and then I hear that people can't tell the difference between my effort and something that is just completely fabricated, that I don't even know the answer to your question, but I just, when you click on things, look to see. So I guess a lot of the fake sites have .co or, you know, just see. And before you start reading the headline or even the first paragraphs, look at the website. It starts with not the fake. There would be no market for fake copy if there weren't people indiscriminately reading. So I am calling out, pleading with you guys as consumers to be more discriminating in what you choose to click on and read.
I think one of the problems with Twitter, Kara, is that it has become a press pass. Yeah. So everyone has a press pass to go to all these games now by having Twitter because they're all commentators. You just have to try to look at more than one source before you determine if it's factual. Mm. I tell all my young students that you can't use Wikipedia as your sole source for a story. As a matter of fact, you need to give me two or three different sources because Wikipedia can be edited by anyone. So what you're going to have to do is you go out there in doing your work in college and in life is you've got to really know where you're getting your information from and you've got to check it and double check it. Nobody does that better than the New York Times. You know, I've gotten calls in articles about fact checks, like they won't go to print unless they know exactly what's going on. So, you know, trust your instincts, but you've got to research stuff and you can't rely and trust, unfortunately, a lot of the stuff that's out there.
And I just wanted to add, this might seem like a non sequitur, but the last story that I had in our paper really gave me such a lesson. And you know, even as someone who's been in the business a long time, you never stop learning or have lessons reinforced. And I was at a Warriors-Suns game, and I was there to talk to Warriors players afterward for a story. And so I'm set up in the auxiliary press row, and everyone surrounding me has at least three devices, an iPad, a phone, a smartphone, and a laptop. And they're working all these devices during the game. And they're on their Twitter deck, and they've got their texting, and they're watching replays or other games on their iPad. So the first quarter ends, and again, the action is halted, so none of these people are paying attention to what's going on. And so I'm sitting there with my notebook and my pen, and I'm watching the court, and they have this presentation. This woman gets up, and they announce her as the first female police chief of Phoenix. She just had been sworn in 2 days earlier. And I look up and I think, wow, that's cool. What kind of a reaction is she going to get in these very difficult times? Everyone gets up and gives her a standing ovation. And I look at the video board, and you can tell that she's struggling to keep it together, that she was not expecting this outpouring of support. And then I notice that the person leading the cheers, the most outgoing of the players, is this Phoenix Suns player. And then the announcer says, and for those of you who don't know, Jerry Williams is the mother of our Phoenix Suns reserve center, Alan Williams. And I thought, holy cow, when you have professional athletes who are protesting police brutality, and here you have a professional athlete whose mother has just made history as the police chief in the city in which he plays, this is a story. And so, you know, when we're talking about fake news, I never understand why people want to make things up, because there are so many great stories all around us. But please, as much as you're able to, put down your devices so that you are open to seeing them. Because if I had been, nobody else on that row thought that was a story.
Thanks to Berra Museum Director Dave Kaplan for co-sponsoring the panel. For more information on this or any edition of Carpe Diem, contact us at carpediem@montclair.edu or call 973-655-5158. I'm Marc Rosenweig. For all of us at Montclair State University, thanks for watching Carpe Diem.